On April 16th, 1958, Rosalind Franklin died from ovarian cancer. But she left a lasting legacy for her leadership in the discovery of DNA and most of the science of biology. She also became a symbol of women's rights and roles in science in the 20th century. She was the first woman that really made it in science. This is the story of Photo 51. This is the story of Rosalind Franklin's search for DNA.
Rosalind Franklin was born on July 25th, 1920, into a family that taught her sports just like a boy at the time would play, competitions like they would, never treating her differently from boys and men. In her household, she was included in anything the rest of her family did. She would discuss science with her father and go to a fairly ordinary school. They allowed her to disregard dolls and instead pursue other interests like drawing, reading, and writing. Based on her background, it's not surprising that she went into the field of science, even though it was not socially acceptable at the time. After her time at home, going through elementary school, through high schools at St. Paul's Girls' School, she excelled in and found great love in chemistry. By age 15, Rosalind knew what she wanted to do with her life, go into science. However, even though she was in a fairly progressive family, allowing women more freedom than they would get in most others, there was still quite a bit of pushback, especially from Ellis Franklin, Rosalind's father, about going into science.
Rosalind found a scholarship to college at Cambridge, a college where women could actually get in, though would not receive all the benefits of being a male student, where she decided to major in chemistry and natural sciences. Highly unusual for women at the time. Because she completely dived into her work at Cambridge, often spending 8 1/4 hours a day in the lab, Rosalind was overexhausted when her graduation came around and only got a second-rate degree. And as the times were still that women were not supposed to get jobs, so the degree was only titular. As a blossoming new scientist, she was asked to work at the British Coal Utilization Research Association. There she first could use the X-ray crystallography methods taught to her in college. She was alright with this job at first, but several years later came to dislike it. She asked her friend Adrian Wheels for help, and soon found work at an institute in Paris, where she added even more knowledge to the techniques and technicalities of X-ray diffraction.
All these bits and pieces of background came together at her latest job at King's College. There, she was promised work to use her skills in X-ray diffraction to help solve the question of life, the mystery of DNA. The work greatly excited her, and she plowed into it. However, problems began to arise. Rosalind, who grew up in an argumentative, liberal, feminist household, was not pleased at all by the gender segregationist, moreover, men's college.
The rule of life at King's, by which, at lunchtime, the men and the women had different luncheon rooms, you see. I'm told this isn't so, and she felt this a great deprivation and a discrimination. Well, it was the old way of things. Just as at Oxford, there were men's colleges and women's colleges, which is not now the case. Of course, they're all mixed.
But worse, and what may have proven to be the reason of her jeopardized legacy, Maurice Wilkins and Rosalind Franklin both have appeared to hate each other on sight. Wilkins began his famous career as part of the Manhattan Project, but he then came to King's College to start as deputy head of the laboratory. With clashing personalities and clashing amounts of power, the problem mainly started because when Rosalind first came to King's College, Maurice Wilkins was on a work trip, and by the time he came back, his PhD research assistant was under supervision of Rosalind, and the woman Rosalind, who he thought would work under him as his assistant, was now working beside him, often exceeding the amount of work that he did. Rosalind's dedication to her work and personality really came out during this period, though sometimes for the worse. Maurice Wilkins said her attitude was very fierce, you know. She denounced and made it quite impossible, as far as I was concerned, to have a sensible conversation. I simply had to walk away. Rosalind was very productive during her time at work at King's College, but she was also very protective of her data. It turned out to be for good reason that she was hired, as she put a completely new face on the laboratory for X-ray diffraction. Rosalind, with her PhD student Gosling, created a laboratory of X-ray diffraction. Finally, after years at King's and a 100-hour development period, she took the first clean, organized, beautiful picture of deoxyribonucleic acid, or DNA. In May 1952, Rosalind Franklin took the first picture of DNA, the picture that would one day help to discover and prove the structure of it.
By now, Rosalind had grown tired of the atmosphere at King's and decided to leave, but Wilkins still had his dislikings with her, some that would change history. Watson and Crick were at the time working also on the structure of DNA in Cambridge, completely separate work from Franklin's and Wilkins' work in King's College. They had solidified their theory as to the structure of DNA. All they needed was more conclusive evidence for their findings. That evidence came in the form of Photo 51 and other scientific documents from Rosalind's lab, leaked to them by Maurice Wilkins. With this photograph in hand, they were astonished to see that the structure of type B DNA, when a certain amount of water is added to the DNA, had some resemblance to a helix structure, and from careful study, even more could be discerned from the image. The instant I saw the picture, my jaw fell open, and my pulse began to race. James Watson.
He was given her famous photograph, 151, or whatever it was, behind her back. She didn't know that it had been handed over. It was her own research, and I think Wilkins or one of her research students allowed Watson to see it, and this confirmed what Watson had possible, or was one of the possibilities he'd been considering, and made a huge difference.
That was the final nail in the coffin for Francis Crick and James Watson. They published their structure of DNA in the same issue of Nature magazine as the paper that Rosalind and Gosling, her graduate student, published their findings in. But Rosalind and Gosling's article went mainly unnoticed. By the time that Rosalind had died of ovarian cancer in 1956, Watson and Crick mainly received credit in the discovery of the secrets of DNA. In 1962, the Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine went to Maurice Wilkins, Francis Crick, and James Watson. None of them even mentioned Rosalind Franklin during their speeches. Would they have if she was still alive to defend her work? We'll never know. Finding the structure of DNA was the most important part in mapping the human genome, which is used in every area of biology. Today, we use DNA for a whole host of things, solving crimes more easily and effectively, finding causes and cures for diseases, figuring out how plants or animals grow and develop, and even how the human body works. Discovering the secrets of DNA has launched us into a new age of biology, that we may accomplish biologic feats that people of the past may never have dreamed of, including even genetically engineering genetic diseases out of babies before they're even born, even curing the affliction of cancer that killed Rosalind Franklin. This is the legacy that Rosalind Franklin left behind. This is why we chose this topic. It affects everyone.